Hello everyone, my name is João Pedro and today I'm going to talk about the verification and assessment of an open source solver for the filling stage of the injection molding process. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Joseph Nagy for letting me participate in this third edition of OIM. All the work has been developed in the Institute for Polymer and Composites from the University of Meath. Through this presentation, I'll first introduce the injection molding process, then the main motivations and objectives that led to the development of this work, the background or the mathematical foundation employed in both softwares used in this work, materials and models, case studies and the main results obtained with them, and finally conclusions and future work. Injection molding process consists of making a polymer melt to fill a mold cavity under pressure. More precisely, first, the polymer pellets are melted to a molten state inside an injection machine. After that, due to the advance of a screw, the polymer melt are forced to fill a mold cavity that presents a geometry close to the final part to be obtained, in a stage called filling. After cooling and solidification, the plastic product is ejected. First, I would like to introduce the motivation and objectives that led to the development of this work. Injection molding process is a high-cost process, especially due to the robustness of the molds used and the several processing conditions associated with it. Thus, numerical modeling tools can play an important role to optimize the process. These tools are usually proprietary software, and consequently, it is difficult to adapt the code to our specific needs. Moreover, the cost of proprietary licenses to work with commercial softwares may limit its adoption to small by small and medium-sized companies. Therefore, in the injection molding market, there was a turning attention for open-source numerical modeling software. This idea summarizes our main motivation to the development of this work, and as a long-term objective, we intend to develop an open-source solver for the numerical modeling of all the injection molding process that is available to everyone. With this work specifically, our objective was the validation and assessment of OpenIngMoldSim, an open source solver developed in the computational library OpenFOAM for the filling stage of the injection molding process. In order to make a full assessment or a full validation of OpenIngMoldSim, we compare the results obtained with it with the ones obtained with MoldX3D, which is a commercial software widely employed in the industry. For that, we need to assure that both OpenIngMoldSim and MoldX3D solve the exactly same mathematical foundation. This means mass, linear momentum, and energy conservation equations. To track the progression of the polymer melt inside the cavity, both softwares use VOF or volume of fluid method. With this model, we can determine the relative volume fraction of the two phases based on an indicator function called alpha. This indicator function ranges from 0 to 1 values, where 0 represents the air and 1 represents the polymer melt. Obviously, the interface is located for values of alpha between 0 and 1. This way, the physical properties are calculated as an average weighted by the respective volume fraction. The artificial velocity term is an extra term that only happens in the interface in order to minimize its diffusivity. And as you can see in the figure, its effect is represented in the figure. The material used in the calculations was a polystyrene Styrene 678 from America Styrenics. The rheological constitutive model chosen to give the variation of the viscosity with shear rate, temperature, and pressure was a cross-WLEF. This model was chosen because it is widely employed in the injection molding studies and represents adequately the behavior of the employed material at the range of temperatures that was considered in the different studies. The evolution of viscosity with each field is demonstrated in the figure, as you can see. Since both OpenIngMoldSim and MoldX3D are made on a compressible basis, the modified tight model was chosen as equation of state because it is the model that gives the most realistic results. To assess the effects that compressibility has in the filling stage of the injection molding process, two formulations of the modified tight model were created. One called compressible, which is the realistic one, and it is given in the figure, as you can see, where the specific volume varies linearly with both temperature and pressure following a slope until the glass transition temperature, or TG. After TG, the slope increases. The second formulation created was created in order to mimic the truly incompressible formulations for polymeric materials, which is given by this black line. And in all the calculations, made in this work, the value of the specific volume that does not vary with any of both properties was defined as 1.75 centimeters cubic per gram. The first case study was employed with the objective of getting more insights about the process. Many authors defend that in the filling stage, the polymer melt should be considered incompressible because it reduces the computational effort without affecting significantly the accuracy of the final results. Others defend that the compressible characteristics of the polymer melts should always be considered because it gives a better transition for the packing phase and gives a better representation of the flow inside the cavity. To fix this discussion, we implemented a rectangular cavity with the material entering through the inlet boundary phase with a velocity of 1.46 meters per second and a temperature of 230 degrees. On the mold walls, there was no velocity and the mold temperature was defined as 50 degrees Celsius with a heat transfer coefficient defined as 1250 watt per meter square Kelvin. At the outlet, since the air leaves the cavity, the atmospheric pressure was selected. The material used in the calculations was the polystyrene presented before, the styrene 678, with the cross-WLEF rheological model. As equation of state, both formulations of the modified type model was used, compressible and incompressible, and the objective was to measure the differences imposed by considering the polymer melt as incompressible. The air was modeled as Newtonian, and the ideal gas was used for the equation of state. The switchover point was defined as 98% of the cavity volume field. A mesh refinement study was employed with the objective to understand if the results obtained with quartz, medium, and refined meshes were similar, and for that, the number of cells in each direction of the rectangular cavity was double for each level of refinement. Therefore, for each level of refinement, the total number of cells increased by 8 times. Since the conclusions obtained with quartz, medium, and refined levels were similar, the results that I will present you are only are the ones considering the most refined mesh, I mean M3, which means the most accurate results. In terms of runtime, the incompressible formulation saved 5% considering the compressible one. And in terms of the total pressure needed to fill the rectangular cavity, the differences were only of 0.9%. In order to later being able to replicate this case study experimentally, the evolution of the inlet pressure was measured. The evolution of the inlet pressure with time was measured, and you can see that at 0.4 there is an increase of the slope of the inlet pressure because the polymer melt is divided because of the cylindrical insert, as you can see in the figures, and therefore, since the cross section becomes narrowed, there is an increase in the slope of the inlet pressure. Later, between 0.6 and 0.7, there is a jump in the inlet pressure. That happens because there are some air entrapments near the mold walls close to the cylindrical insert, as you can see on the figures on the right. and more pressure needs to be applied in order to make the polymer melt to fill to fill these gaps. Therefore, between 0.6 and 0.7 exists that pressure peak. I'd like to notice that both formulations follow exactly the same behavior. To end this case study, we analyzed the velocity contours and the temperature contours at both cross-sections presented before, S1 and S2, and we noticed that in the velocity contours, no visible differences were depicted. Therefore, in order to measure the differences caused by imposing the polymer melt as incompressible, we measured the average and maximum velocities in these cross-sections. We noticed that the differences were below 1%. The same procedure was employed for temperature contours because, once again, the temperature contours in both cross-sections were similar, and analyzing the minimum and maximum temperatures in each cross-section, the differences were below 4%. With this case study and the results obtained with it, we can conclude that incompressible formulation might be a good assumption for the filling stage of the injection molding process because it saves some computational effort without affecting significantly the accuracy of the final results. In the second case study, a tensile test specimen with feeding system was employed to make a direct comparison between OpenInj MoldSim and MoldX3D. It is a geometry widely employed in industry for material mechanical characterization. And with this case study, we intend to create a case study that could be replicated experimentally. The initial and boundary conditions are the same from the previous case study, with the exception of the inlet velocity, which is now defined as 1.4 meters per second. Once again, the switchover point was defined as 98% of the cavity volume field. The material used was the general purpose polystyrene styrene 678 presented before, and the cross-WLF rheological model was selected once again. In terms of equation of state, only the compressible formulation was selected because it is the formulation that gives the most realistic results. The air was modeled exactly in the same manner as before. A mesh refinement study was performed because we could not use the exact same meshes on both softwares. Therefore, we performed the mesh refinement study in order to obtain converged solutions, which means that do not depend on the mesh size, and then we compare the converged results. This approach was also employed because when analyzing the same levels of refinement for each software, we noticed that the density of cells in OpenInj MoldSim, it was clearly higher than in MoldX3D. Therefore, with converged solutions, we eliminate the cell size variable from the calculations. Analyzing the pressure contours at the switchover point obtained with each software, we noticed that they are qualitatively the same. Furthermore, we noticed that the flow front obtained in OpenInj MoldSim was much more realistic than in MoldX3D because it progressed in a parabolic way due to the non-velocity on the mold walls, and in MoldX3D it progressed like a flat. Applying the Richardson's extrapolation to all levels of refinement and measuring the errors obtained with each mesh, we noticed that MoldX3D needed at least one more level of refinement in order to reach the same magnitude of errors of OpenFOAM. Analyzing the temperature contours in the cross-section presented before, MoldX3D gives us a non-physical temperature contour. We suspect that this non-physical contour is due to the low density of cells in the core region of that cross-section. However, since MoldX3D isn't a commercial software, there are some tools that are not available for the user, and therefore we could not confirm our theory. Anyway, applying the Richardson extrapolation and making the procedure employed for the pressure field, we noticed that even for the coarsest levels of refinement, both softwares can deal well with temperature with the errors below 1%. Finally, analyzing the velocity contours, we noticed an inconsistency between the contours given by OpenInj MoldSim and MoldX3D in that cross-section. Since we knew that The average value in that cross-section should be around 40 centimeters per second. And since the mold walls are not animated of velocity, as you can see in both contours, the material that flows in the central shaft, in the core region of that cross-section, needs to flow at a velocity much higher than the 40 centimeters per second in order to obtain an average of that value. This means that the contour given by MoldX3D is completely wrong. Either way, applying the Richardson extrapolation to each level of refinement and analyzing the errors for each mesh, we notice that just like the pressure field, MoldX3D needed at least one more level of refinement in order to obtain the same magnitude of errors of open foam. Since we were not satisfied with the results given by MoldX3D, we used the commercial software to make a last study. This time we simulated only the central channel of the tensile test specimen, as you can see on the figure on the left, and the same initial and boundary conditions, the same material was considered. A mesh refinement study was also employed to understand where to the velocity values evolve with the mesh refinement. In the end, we noticed that with mesh refinement, the velocity values and the velocity contours evolve in order to approximate themselves from the ones obtained with open hinge mold seam in the previous slide. Finally, and since we wanted to create a case study that could be replicated experimentally, the evolution of the inlet pressure with time was measured. In this feature, we found out three particular intervals with pressure perturbations. The first one happened between 0.1 and 0.2, and the pressure peak happened only on MoldX3D. This interval corresponds to the division of the melt front through gate and through the cold slug and main runner. But since in MoldX3D at 0.1 seconds, the melt front is already at the main runner, this pressure peak happened without a specific reason. The second interval happened between 0.3 and 0.4, which corresponds to the passage of the melt front through the gate. The gate is a very thin and small channel, and therefore it offers a high resistance to the flow. In order to make the polymer melt to fill or to flow through these gaps, more pressure needs to be applied. Since more pressure is applied, it was expected that in the inlet pressure, a pressure peak would happen in this interval. The pressure peak was resisted only by open hinge mold seam. Finally, the third interval happened between 0.5 and 0.8, and it corresponds to the passage of the melt front through the thinner channel of the tensile test specimen, as you can see on the figures. Since the cross-section in this region decreases, it was expected that the slope of the inlet pressure in this interval would increase, and at 0.8, as you can see on the image on the right side, as the material leaves the thinner channel and the cross-section increases again, the slope of the inlet pressure should decrease. This behavior was resisted by open hinge mold seam, and MoldX presented many oscillations in this interval. Finally, to end this case study, we made a global analysis of accuracy and performance. From the results obtained, we conclude that MoldX3D needed at least one more level of refinement to reach the same magnitude of errors of open foam or open hinge mold seam. However, contrary to what happened in open hinge mold seam, the different fields in MoldX did not converge asymptotically, especially the velocity ones. These results presented an oscillatory convergence. This makes that Richardson's extrapolated values that were used to calculate the errors are less precise, which originates a lack of accuracy in the results obtained in MoldX3D. All these results showed us that open hinge mold seam presents a better accuracy than MoldX3D. Finally, in terms of performance, we analyzed the performance for each level of refinement, and Analyzing the M1 level in both softwares, we noticed that Moldex 3D was 523 times faster than the opening Mold Sim. When analyzing levels of refinement with the same order of magnitude, which means M3 in Moldex 3D and M2 in OpenInge Mold Sim, the commercial software was only 10 times faster than the open source one. Analyzing M4 in Moldex 3D and M3 in OpenInge Mold Sim, the difference is considering 48 cores reduced to 4 times only. In fact, we could not make simulations using the same parallelization conditions in both softwares, especially because Moldex 3D is a commercial software and therefore it is limited to the number of licenses available to work, which is not a concern for open source softwares. In fact, if we take full potential of parallelization power of OpenFOAM, given by the simulations ran in 96 and 192 cores, we managed to obtain in OpenInge Mold Sim the same performance of Moldex 3D. I would like to recall that the results obtained with Moldex 3D are not converged yet, and therefore another level of refinement should be employed. However, we lack the necessary computational resources needed to run an even more refined mesh. As main conclusions, this work showed us that incompressible formulations might be a good assumption for the filling stage of the injection molding process. OpenInge Mold Sim presents a better accuracy than Moldex 3D, and the velocity contours provided by the proprietary software require a more detailed analysis. In terms of performance, Moldex 3D is clearly faster than the open source software. I'd like to notice that if we take full potential of the parallelization power of OpenFOAM, the open source solver can match the performance of the proprietary one. As future work, we intend to make some experimental assessment of the numerical results obtained, prepare similar studies with other parts and different polymeric materials, implement a fully incompressible formulation in order to end the first case study presented in this work, improve the numerical algorithm to make the solver more efficient, perform additional studies to identify the calculation accuracy required in industrial practice, and finally introduce numerical solution for packing and cooling stages. Thank you all for your attention and stay safe.